The second topic of the session is our world and their world. Sometimes the authors have clearly projected their own fears and prejudices onto the subject of their piece and spoken for them from that place. Let us not assume that empathy equals experience. That's all about the second session of the second day. The topic is our world and their world. It's a discussion on the writers and artists take on physically and mentally challenged people, and the experts are Dr. Pratibha Ray, Mr. B. Maria Kumar, Dr. Debasis Panikrahi, Shruti Mahapatra, Mr. Pradeep Ishwar, and the session will be moderated by Mr. Nitin Chandra. I invite all the guests onto the dais. Dr. Pratibha Ray, Mr. B. Maria Kumar, Dr. Debasis Panikrahi, Shruti Mahapatra, Mr. Pradeep Ishwar, and Mr. Nitin Chandra.
Unless we consciously cultivate the art of bridging the disconnection, I think this disconnect would persist. I'm very happy that we have a very distinguished panel here. All are very experts and stalwarts in their own areas, and we have very distinguished members from the audience also. I feel very delighted to be part of this session. I'll speak much later after the panelists have given their views on the subject. But just broadly give you a flavor of what is the position in the country as a whole and our own state so far as disability is concerned. The last survey which was done on disability was in 2011 by the census. And during that census, the enumerators had taken the definition of disability as given in the law of 1995, the disability law of 1995. And at that time, there were only 7 disabilities. Now the new law has come in 2016, which is now in force from 2017. And under this law, the disability categories have gone up from 7 to 21. So it's a huge increase. So by the survey of 2011, what they have found is that almost 2.4% of the total population of the country has this disability, of the kind which is explained in the law of 95. And in Odisha, we have a higher proportion, and it's more than 2.4%. And the number is around 12.44 lakh people who are suffering from some disability or the other, as given in the law of 95. With this law coming into force, our first task, in fact, is to begin enumeration and find out what is now the new number. Our estimate is that the numbers would go up by at least 4 to 5 times. 4 to 5 times. I would be happy if I am proved wrong. But the kind of categories which have been included, hemophilia, then multiple sclerosis, Parkinson's, acid attack victims, and dwarfism. Very interesting, dwarfism. And what is the definition of dwarf? Dwarf. Dwarfism is also included. And what is the definition of dwarf? I think many of us might come under dwarf category. It's 4 feet 10 inches. I find this was a good height, 4 feet 10 inches. I've come across a lot of people. But then it is dwarf. And that becomes a disability. So in inches, it is 147 inches. So, muscular dystrophy, then you have new categories in Parkinson's disease, I've already mentioned. And the list is actually, you know, kept open-ended, which means anytime if the central government thinks fit, they can add another category of disability also. So, be that as it is, our first task is to enumerate. We'll enumerate the we'll have a fresh survey of the population, and we'll have to find out. For that, we have to give good publicity about the act, that these are the categories, so that people can come forward and make their claims. Going to be a very Herculean task. We just had a discussion on these things just 2 days back in Government of India, when Minister of the Department of Disability and Secretary and all of us were having discussion. And we all agreed that the first challenge is to, you know, make publicity of the act itself and tell people that there are so many new disabilities added, and therefore those who are suffering from these disabilities should come forward and make their claims under the Disability Act. First claim being that give me a disability certificate. So this is what we plan to do. But I'll not go beyond that. Many more interesting things other speakers would have to add. I think the order of speaker, I think we'll give respect, or we'll have deference to the seniority by age, I think. So I think Madam Pratibha Ray is the most suitable person to begin this session and give us some of her thoughts on this matter. Thank you. Exactly. You are very right. I don't think we will constrain ourselves by taking the legal definition of the disability. I think let it be open to the speakers. Let them say, because I have my own definition of disability, which is very different from... Yes, 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 yes. Sir, right. So I would not like to constrain to the definition of disability in terms of the law itself. So writers and speakers might have different perspectives. So it will be, in fact, enriched by a wider variety of perspectives. Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you very much. Friends, I think Manu Babu has invited me and included me in this session, because I have written one novel and two, three stories on this topic. I think this is the reason. Otherwise, I don't have very much work on this field. Shruti, my very dear Shruti, has invited me several times to be associated in their work and organization. But I could not, because of their lack of time, so many works. I'm sorry. I think she's angry with me. I wish to do something, but several works are there. So there it is not possible to actively participate, but mentally I am always with her. First thing I should say to Manu Babu, we have discussed over phone several times, once before this lit fest, about this topic. I think Manu Babu, this topic was not disclosed to me during our conversation. The topic is our world, their world. Is it not? Okay. But this topic was not revealed to me. Exact topic was not revealed to me, that this will be the topic for this day. What you now complain, that why artists and writers are not taking up this subject? Okay, your agony. You feel bad. Why this topic is not taken by writers and painters? You cannot force a writer or painter to do whatever they like. Paint this, write this. You cannot force a writer like this. It is not creativity. Whenever they feel attracted to something, they will write. whenever they will experience and they feel pain, when they are disturbed, restless, regarding a topic, regarding a subject, regarding a particular situation, they will definitely paint and write. Okay, that is a different thing. Regarding the topic, our world and their world, we are really living in a divided world. So many divisions, our and their, tribals, non-tribals, Hindu, Muslim, BJP, BJD, like this, so many divisions. And like this today, our and their. I think there is only one world, our world. They are we are they. Why we will be special? We all are differently disabled. What Shruti can do, I cannot do. Shruti can do 10 things, 100 things, I am doing one thing. Do you know? Therefore, I sincerely feel, that we all are differently disabled. So therefore, this disabled word, I don't like. We all are able to do something. Let us take it positively. No negativity is here. You know the style of life, the statistics you came to know just now from Honorable Nitish Chandraji. So every day in this our modern life, the hazards we are facing, every day we are meeting some accidents, some explosion, terrorism, and how many people are losing their limbs, losing their hands, many things, eyes. You see in Kashmir, by stone throwing, how many police are injured and how many young boys are losing their eyes. So many things are happening in this world, whole world. So every day, if you negatively take it, every day we are becoming more and more disabled. But our motto is, dear life, what comes, I love you. This is our motto. And I learned from Shruti. I don't know Shruti has read this story, Ratnamudi. I sent that magazine to you.
Yes, one book has come, but I have not read.
You ignored.
No, not ignore. Please,
I wrote a story, Ratnamudi. Maybe Shruti is the center. So I like that story. Shruti should read it. That is not translated in any other language. This is a book. My job as a writer, if I will experience something and feel disturbed, feel love towards something, I write. This book I wrote, I think, in 84. The book, name of the book is Dehatita, Beyond the Body. Dehatita means beyond the body. How many people live beyond the body? We all are living, taking our body. From the beginning in the morning, we have a headache, today we are not feeling well, we are having cold, today is very hot, like this. We are living in our body. So we are not living, we exist. That is not living. But some people live beyond the body. It is a true story. And on a girl who became paralyzed at the age of maybe 12. She was a Odisha dancer and daughter of a very big person. I am not going to, everybody knows, I am not going to reveal the name. Nobody is no more, parents are no more, the girl is no more. So she was actually living in front of my house at Cuttack and she was reading all my books. She became paralyzed after one operation in spinal cord. you might be knowing. And then I didn't know. I just heard that so-and-so's daughter is not well. She's lying like that for so many years because of paralysis. But that much I knew. One day I got a phone from her. Pratibhapa, I am a great fan of yours. I read all your books. Why are you not coming? I want to see you. I didn't know that she's totally paralyzed. She can't come. So I thought, why don't you come? You are a child, you come. I have so many works. She said that I am just a little bit sick. Immediately I cannot go. But she was totally paralyzed since so many years. There was point of no return. And she said that I will come one day, but just now I cannot come, but I am very, very much anxious to see you. I said, okay, I will come. I went there. She was sleeping like this. Very sweet girl, tall, sweet, and very sweet smile. Nobody can think that she is totally paralyzed from here, from waist. So then his father came, a very big ex-military person. He came and told me, she has not called you, Pratibha, I called you. I said, why, Mosa? Tell me, if anything I can do, what has happened to her? Is she suffering from fever or something? Therefore I called you, for her only. I said, for what? In front of her, he said, I am telling you the truth. In front of her, he said, you will write an application to, in the name of this girl, that in this novel I named her Swaha, to president, to prime minister, to chief minister, to many, many big persons. Mughalai, about what? Is she very sick? She needs any help? Yes. You will write one application that they will allow her to commit suicide. Commit suicide. I was shocked. And she was like this, expressionless face, looking to the roof. In front of her, he is telling like that. Then I said, why are you telling like that, Mosa? What happened to her? Have you not seen the wheelchair while coming, entering into the house? I was shocked. I could not imagine that this girl, this sweet girl, is in wheelchair. Then he said that this happened to her after an operation. She is like that since last 8 years, and she will not never recover. And I spent 4 years in hospital. Doctors stopped coming. Then I went to temples. God didn't listen. Now I have stopped going to temple and going to doctors. So after our death, husband and wife are there. What she will do? She will not be able to drink a glass of water. Without water she can die. So what can I answer? I said, okay, Mosa, God is there. We are not there to decide what to do. He said, you are senior or I am senior. What you are telling God about God? Where is God? Can you call God to see her? God will come and give her a glass of water? What was happening? She had no sensation from waist to feet. And sometimes aunts were eating. There are abscess, and aunts were eating, and it was operated. She never felt any pain, and only bones. He showed me the legs, only two bones. So I came home. I said, Mosa, everything will be taken care of by somebody, and I am coming, and I will come. And he said that, I know that you will not come again, Because I have told, I have requested many people to write an application. Nobody has written application, and after that nobody has come. But what happened, I was attracted to that girl. I was drawn to that girl. And every day, almost every day, after returning from college, I was in Ravensha in that time, and I went to her. And her day-to-day life, I saw. I am not going to do the entire story to you. Then I saw one very positive outlook. A girl who is lying like that, and at that time she was 24. Since last 12 years she was lying like that. And she was not reading, but she knows everything about the world. Politics, religion, literature, everything. One room was her role, and he loves everybody. He knew names of my children. And he remembered the date of birth, and every birthday she sent some gifts for my children, like this. So, not for me, for many people. So one day, I went there. She told that I was actually in wheelchair, going to bazaar, going to in front of your house, and I was thinking to come to your house. But when I come out to bazaar, people look with so much pity, I don't like. From that day, I stopped going in wheelchair. Therefore, I called you. So then, I wrote a story, because she reads all my stories. One day I saw that she is embroidering a face of Lord Jagannath in a frame, and singing a song, a very sweet song, singing. I saw her and I asked, are you in love with somebody? Unless you are in love with somebody, you cannot live like this. Must be some inspiration behind your life. I joke with her, like normal people. We never discussed about her ailment. Never. And she never complained. Then she said, yes, how did you know? I said that I feel that you are in love. Who is that fortunate person? Then she said, my lover is such a person. He is lover of everybody. I said, who? He showed me the photo of Jagannath on the wall. He is my lover. If my Lord, he said, if my Lord, having no leg, having no head, hand, he is moving all around the world and doing everything, and he is controlling the whole world. So why should I be unhappy? I have legs, I have hands, and the hand was very active. She was doing cake, sleeping there, making clay cakes, and everything. Then I thought that, I think I am, at that time handicaps, the word was used for them, physically handicapped. I thought, I think she is not, I am a handicapped person. The nice way she is living, I am not living in that way, like that. Sometimes I feel that I am unfit, I could not do this, I could not do that, so many works are lying like that. I am not in mental peace. So she is in mental peace, she is living her life fully and loving everybody all around her, the neighbors. A small Muslim boy comes, she loves. So I wrote a story which was broadcast in the TV. In that, I know that she is dying. She was dying. I wrote a very positive story. I said that, Anju, sorry, I said her name, you listen to the story. She was very happy. But Mausa was not happy. Moses said, a story is always story. You people do what do? You people write story. If you get a topic like this, subject like this. But what we are suffering, we cannot know. So one day she died in front of me, but died peacefully and with all positive thinking to any. One day I have not listened that why God is so cruel for me, to Dwapara. Why he did this to me? He did so many things lying like that. This novel is totally true with little bit imagination and little bit imaginary characters, 2-3 imaginary characters. And their parents came to know. And they said that you have written a book on our daughter, we want to read. They read it and they have not blamed me. I have made her a very positive character. Anybody will fall in love with that character, you go through it. So I think therefore he, so what I am going to tell you, we should not pity if something happens. Who knows? We are now okay. We are not okay. According to the definition of health by WHO, in 48, that definition stands now. Here, those who are present here, nobody is healthy. Nobody is healthy. Those who are wearing glass, they are not healthy. I am not having sound sleep, I am not healthy. Having cavity in my teeth, not healthy. So according to that, nobody is healthy in this world. But we are living. So like that, they are not separate from us. We belong to one world and we should live together and we'll embrace them, they will embrace us. They will teach us. We have to learn many things from them, from Shruti. I think in this hall, what Shruti is doing, nobody is doing that. At a time, so many words. And the social work she's doing, we are not doing. We are selfish people, we are doing for ourselves. So I wrote a story. Suppose she would have been an IAS officer, like Nitin Chandraji. What more she would have done? Tell me. I think you would not have done more things than what you are doing now. I feel that you are free to what you feel doing better for other people, the disadvantaged people. You are not disadvantaged. There are so many disadvantaged people you are doing for them. So, thank you very much. My point is, we should not pity them. They should pity us. We are not doing so many things like them. And we are together, and we should join hands, and we are one family, and there is no word like they and we, their world and our world. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Now let's hear Pradeep, I think.
Esteemed chair, and the panelists, friends. While talking of their world and our world, I think I'm in a dilemma in the sense that I am in both the worlds. I'm parent to a mentally challenged Sean. So I've seen the other world very closely for last almost 20 years. What I find, saying something, writing something, is not so important in the context that it cannot solve their problem, the trauma they face in life. Shruti Madam is there. She's extremely talented. She should have joined in IAS. She's a very good, a very fine poet. Now she's a social worker. She's doing a lot. But still, there is some vacuum which can never be fulfilled. So far literature is concerned, I don't think words can express everything in life. Life is much vaster than, it is much bigger than what the words can express. In Odia literature, we have very few writings on this. Recently, I had the opportunity of going through a novel by Sushmita Bakshi, the wife of Surat Bakshi. And it is on this mentally challenged children.
Not mentally challenged.
And
exceptional children.
Yes, exceptionally. Yeah. And it is very passionate, it is a very passionate story.
Autistic
children. Yes. And it brings out the other dimensions of the person of these children. Long back I had written a poem, Pua Prati in Odia. It was enacted in Ravindra Mandap. Now I have a translation that I think it is the occasion I must read it out. And I think what I want to say, I have said that in this poem. To my son, my dear son, my dear son, I offer you my tongue. Tell me, my dear son, tell me whatever you want. I donate you my feet. I donate you my feet. Go, go, wherever you want to go. Take my eyes, my dear son. Take my eyes and dream of your own. All these belong to you. Your defenseless silence has snatched away the voice from me. Your defenseless silence has snatched away the voice from me. Thinking about you, I have forgotten the art of dreaming. Thinking about you, I have forgotten the art of dreaming. My dear son, do fly if you could. Do fly if you could. The limitless sky is open for you. The limitless sky is open for you. Don't be panic of my broken wings. Don't be panic of my broken wings. Don't be afraid of the sky. Don't be afraid of the sky. Looking at your wings flapping, I am sure one day you would be able to map the whole sky. Looking at the wings flapping, I am sure one day you would be able to map the whole sky, my dear son. Do fly if you could. Do fly if you could. So, we have to cherish that the children should be able to fly one day. My esteemed friend Manu Das, he has also suffered the same pangs of life as I am. I think that is why he has put this topic today. And you can't just imagine the isolation of the child, the social trauma of the parents. One day, one of my colleagues visited my house. She had brought her daughter. She was almost of the age of my son. So she was also an innocent child. She had drawn a picture of my son and at the end wrote a mad boy. You can't imagine the way my wife cried that day. So it is devastating for the parents of the children, and to groom them to see that they prosper in life. I think my child is fortunate. I am able to provide some grooming. But when I see children in villages, their parents, they are unable to understand the trauma, the problem. They are unable to address the problem. They simply leave them and they are put in chains. They are treated as madmen. So, in that scenario, even in Odisha now, what I find, we do not have our secretary, principal secretary here. In Bhubaneswar itself, we do not have adequate infrastructure for them to grow, to get educated. We have not adequate teachers for them. We have so many problems, and the livelihood opportunities for them in future, that is again an issue. And I think government cannot do everything. The society has to be compassionate for them and see that they come to the mainstream. Mainstreaming these children is a very bigger issue, and for that all of us have to work together. Thank you.
With permission of the chair, I have only one word to tell you.
Thank you very much. I know your trauma. It is, writing is different. Seeing another boy or girl like this and experiencing that as parents is definitely different. I agree with that. Shruti is our Helen Keller. She is the example. Government cannot do everything. Society should come forward. All of us, we society, all of us. Take a resolution here today. What can be done in Bhubaneswar for children like that, for their better education and better life? You must be knowing, Edison has never spoken to the wife and the daughter because both of them were deaf and dumb. So we cannot stop. Maybe science one day stop these things. This is those who are by birth. But after that, what can we do? Okay, okay.
Now, Maria, I think we go over to you.
When I was studying in college, I saw one Telugu film, Padaharella Vaisu. Padaharella Vaisu means 16 years of age. The film has got very good actors in the prime roles like Kamala Hassan, Sridevi, Rajinikanth. And perhaps that was the first film for Sridevi in the main role. The whole story is based around that girl of 16 years, Sridevi. The story was set in a village, and this Kamal Hassan is a rural boy, and this Rajnikant, he is a sort of gunda in that village. And Kamal Hassan is the person with some disability. He can't walk properly. He limps every time. But he has got love for this girl, Sridevi. And that Rajnikant gunda type, he is always an eye for this girl. So one day it so happens one doctor comes to that village saying that he has been posted in the nearby block headquarters, and this girl falls for that doctor. So that Kamal Hassan is after this girl, but she does not allow him to be in her vicinity and he does not respond to him. So she has got some sort of different opinion, views about that Kamal Hassan being, of course, uneducated and limping with that dhoti tied up and almost very symbolizing a sort of uncivilized person. So afterwards it all turns out to be that the doctor says to the girl, I am a doctor and you are a rural girl and I don't want to marry you. So he deserts her and goes to the city. And one day it so happens that Rajnikant gunda gets an opportunity to molest her, and when he was molesting that, this Kamal Hassan happens to see, and by of course he succeeds in eliminating him. So thereby saving the girl, that Sridevi, from that untoward incident. And so he jailed Kamal Hassan for that murder. And the last scene is that Sridevi realizes the beauty of the mind of that Srikant, that Kamal Hassan. So she says that I will wait for you. The film attracted a huge applaud from the public. It was a great success in Telugu, and afterwards it was remade in Tamil also, Padanar Vaidinile. So there is one Hollywood film you must have seen, A Beautiful Mind. Again, it has got very great actor Russell Crowe, who was very famous for his stellar role in Gladiator, for which he got one Oscar also. This Beautiful Mind, A Beautiful Mind, it was based on the story written by one lady, Sylvia Nazar. It is an autobiography of one famous mathematical scientist by name John Nash. So when he was having his prime career in mathematical research in that American university, perhaps it is Princeton or Carnegie, I don't know, I'm forgetting. So then he succumbs to the bouts of delusions, hallucinations, that is a split of mind, sort of disease according to psychiatrists called schizophrenia. And then he happens to fall in love with his student, one girl, Alicia. So, as the intensity of this schizophrenia increases, so he is admitted in that mental asylum, and after having been there for more than 2 decades, then he gets cured and again comes onto the mainstream of his research life, and afterwards for his discoveries he was awarded Nobel Prize for economics. These mathematical formulae were applied in economic theories, and which did some contribution to the welfare of the people in formulating policies. That was in 1994. And then this girl, means later his wife, Alicia, and later on they took divorce from each other, and afterwards at that age of some 70 plus or so, again she reunites him. And about 2 years back, he and Alicia both died in some bus accident. You must have seen in the newspapers. Another real story is about Beethoven. We all know about him, famous musical composer of Germany. Maybe 100 years or 150 back he lived. And he was a sort of prodigy. By the age of 20, he wrote very beautiful compositions, symphonies. But by that time, he was already suffering hearing problem. He was unable to hear. He does not want to tell the world also that he is becoming deaf. He does not want to tell the world. Only his closest friends know that he is getting deaf. He is unable to hear. But even then he goes on creating the best music, because he knows about all the instruments, that the violin or piano, all the instruments, the strings and all those keys and how they sound, and the sort of combinations and permutations of the movement of the keys. So he produces great music, and even at the age of 40, when there was some royal symphony, he has to present it before that king of Germany, Prussia, then also he does not want to reveal his impairment. And we know Stephen Hawking. He says that technology has made him able to work as normal as anybody can be working. So here, artists have portrayed certain characters about the persons with disabilities and certain real life characters. So what I feel, the objective of the writers, artists, sculptors, musicians, painters, whatsoever type of artist he is, that it is not that only when certain people with disabilities, when they get famous, when they achieve something, then they should be portrayed in that very high achieving sort of glaring celebrity type. But they should also look at, of course, in that film of Padharella Vaisu, that he was not a great achiever in that film, that Kamalasan. But even the writer portrayed him as usual, and his routine activities in that film, and that normal the way how she used to detest that Kamala Hassan, even though she does not like him, but afterwards gets attracted, as usual, looking at something more than physical, his mind. So here I feel the artists play a greater role in appreciating the human by virtue of his being human, not by other features which are very, very physical, superficial, trivial. So that's where I think the artist has got a role, and they have done earlier also, but now also they are doing, but they are still, I think, to go further, because ultimately artist looks for the beauty of the mind, especially the character, the nature of beauty. So it can be found in all the people. Of course, there are imperfections, that's what the writers also say, and the architects or various painters. So we know about that great Ashtavakra, who was quite famous for that Ashtavakra Gita in our Puranas. And how the beauty of the persons by virtue of their being human rather than the other characteristics, it all dependent upon the way the artists take up their hobby, their genre of promoting the art and culture. That makes an important thing for all of us, especially for all the writers and painters and musicologists and the artists. And I hope that this kind of thinking will gain further momentum, and I appreciate Sri Manu Dasji for having selected this kind of theme in this festival, because normally, very rarely we come across this kind of theme. So I appreciate him, and thank you.
Shruti.
Esteemed chair and co-panelists, ladies and gentlemen, I bow to the divinity in all of you. First of all, I would like to thank Manu Babu for having decided to have a session on our world and their world. I'm very happy this discourse is happening. And when we just started, and there were some notes of discord, some voices and some opinions, I was delighted, because it took me back to 2005, when I was attending Beijing Plus Five in the United Nations, and there were many caucuses. There were women caucus, there were writers, there were persons with disability, and this is exactly what was happening in the women caucus. Gender equality, and what should we talk about and what we should not talk about. And this brings a lot of enthusiasm, because now you are mainstreamed. Here people want to talk about you, discuss and differ. I remember 1995, when the Person with Disabilities Act was passed, and we had to go through a long series of sitting on dharnas and crying out, and the bill was passed. There was not a single voice of dissent. It was just I, not a single discussion. So when the law comes out and gets president's assent, there are too many lacunae, too many gaps, too many challenges there. But this time, in December 2016 when Rajya Sabha and Lok Sabha were, there were so many points of discussion, argument, disagreements and opinions and counter opinions. I think the only sector which was celebrating it was the disability sector, because now we are mainstreamed. I would like to, I mean, everyone out here is, they are such great people that I really don't know what to speak, but I will just talk about a few facts and figures and then why in all forms of media, dance, drama, music and literature, we should be talking about disability and how. You see, the figure which Sir already has spoken, 2011 census says that we are 2.29 in Odisha. So we are celebrating because we are higher than the national average of 2.21. But if we look at the WHO statistics, what do they say? In 2011, long back, in 2010, WHO said 10%, a conservative estimate, take any village, take any city, take a continent, 10% is always disabled. We didn't listen to that, so we went ahead with our whatever percentage we had. And the shocker was, the Britishers, when they had done a census way back in 1897, I think, the figure was something like 0.297 point, something very small, I don't remember. So after getting the law, when delighted, we were a young bunch of people, all motivated. When we reach and we start asking for a budget, that's when it shocked us. We were told, since your percentage is so low, that's the reason the budget allocated for all development activities vis-a-vis disability is very low. So come 2011, 2001, we were meeting, we were talking, but there was no time. So in 2011, when we meet the Chief Commissioner, Census Commissioner, and we tell them that we need to be counted, and then we have one question devoted all to us, question number 9. Here we are, a bigger figure, a bigger number. Personally, I don't agree with it. Because if you go to states, countries like the US, the percentage in North America, in United States of America, is 18%. If you go to Australia, it is 20%. If you go to even a poverty-stricken place like the Africa, if you go there, Rwanda says we have 7.6% declared, registered official numbers. Come home, come closer to home. Pakistan 7% and Nepal 7-10%. So definitely, as Sir was telling, I agree with it. Our population cannot be less than about 60, 65, 70 lakhs in the state of Odisha. And this number, I want to emphasize again and again, because only when it hits at 60 lakhs, 70 lakhs of people in Odisha who have some or other disability. In every 10 person, you have one person with disability. In every one person, in every person with a family, the fourth person or the sixth person is disabled, that's when we start taking disability seriously. But what happened in this course of time? Why did we become invisible? The reason is, if we go back to the history of mankind, we will find that disability was associated with sins committed in past life. So nobody wanted to associate themselves with a family member having disability. So what do you do with them? You kill them. You burn them alive. You bury them alive. You throw them in some corner of your house and forget about them. So this is how the history of persons with disability started. Even now, I know many educated and elite families who do not like to identify. I can very much share with Pradeep Babu's agony. They don't like to tell in public that they have a family member who has a mental challenge, even now with all the laws in place. And then, as we all know, cruelty is generally succeeded by charity. Then started a phase of charity in the history of disability. We had temples in the east. We had churches in the west, we had pagodas in the far east coming forward and saying, let us give some food to these pitiable objects. So we were given some food, some clothes, and kept it in some corner. Then started another era that happened only after the First World War. 1918, hundreds and thousands of persons coming back home, disabled and disfigured. That's when some society shakes up. Oh, what's happening? These are our friends, family members. Now they're disabled. And that is also the same time people started taking cognizance of people who had mental challenges. Okay, so that's a huge group of people. What do we do with them? We can't throw them away. So it started an era of hospitals and rehabilitation, where doctors and therapists took over our lives. Again, we had no independence. So where are we? We are in three places. You can easily find us. We are in homes, in some dark corner of the home. We are in special schools, or we are in rehabilitation institutes. And what is common to these three places? We are isolated, we are thrown, we are forgotten. So that is how we lived till the 1980s. In the 80s, with the beginning of economic liberalization, everybody started waking up to something. This is also when WHO did a study and came out with a 10% conservative number. Then countries started wondering, 10% of a population, we cannot allow them to sit and eat. Let them do something. That's how vocational rehabilitation came into being. We were doing some activity. So that's how we were slowly moving. Then comes the 90s. The 90s is the age of rights. That's 1980s, actually it started in the US, this identity to be recognized as a human being, to be recognized as a name, as Shruti, not as a disabled woman. So that movement happened very fast in the US, and I met a young lady, I do not remember her name, who went completely naked. She stood in front of the UN and did a beautiful bust of hers, a famous artist, and it was displayed. So that movement started in the Western countries. Here in the 90s, you know, I will give you a small simile. In the British era, the British brought in railways, not for us. They brought it for the movement, easy movement of their goods. But in a very big way, railways helped to unite us and lead us towards independence. Similarly, this education, this special education, whatever you call it, brought to the fore number of educated persons with disability. As was happening in the West, so was happening in India. We had Javed Abidi in New Delhi, a spina bifida person, educated, a journalist. We had Dr. P.K. Malik, a doctor, a wheelchair-born person in Kolkata. We had Anuradha Mohit, completely blind but educated. Then we had Jayashree Ravindran, speech and hearing impaired, a professor in IGNO who was completely shattered with the way everybody was giving her instructions. Then here I was, a Shruti from Odisha. 8 or 9 of us got together and we started discussing. We are taxpayers, we are educated. Why should we be treated like second class citizens? Forget second class citizen, we were no citizen at all, we had no identity. And since we were so much inspired by what's happening in the US, in the UK, all of us jumped on the opportunity. And in 1995, after a lot of resistance, after a lot of fights, we got our first law. 95 to 2016 has been a journey through challenges and more challenges, because nobody wants to accept a person with disability in their family, in their life, and that remains a truth even now. Now what happened? What happened is, it is deep in our psyche that disability is associated with sin or cruelty. Let us go back. Let us go back to our ancient treaties. We go to Mahabharata. And what do we find? Shakuni. The person who is the most hated character is disabled, is limping. Let us go to the Ramayana. Again, the most crooked character is Manthara, A woman who has a huge hunchback, is disabled, is giving all the bad thoughts. And then let us go to the Western movies, Western books, I mean all the English books. In most of the Western films you will find all the bad characters in that film, they are blind. The pirates, they all have a patch in their eye. So that which is there in our psyche of these people are sins, these people are cursed, you know, it, how it is getting reflected. It gets reflected in our literature, gets reflected in our films. I will talk about something very recent. Look at all the Bollywood films of the 80s, 1980s and 90s, when a new style started, the style of stylizing the villains. So all the villains, if you can remember right now, starting from the famous Teza film, Teza, till now you'll find the villain in the film always has some discipline. Cannot walk straight, cannot speak properly, cannot see. So this has happened. It's because over the years, despite laws now, despite everything, we have associated disability with something evil. The other stereotype which exists in the society is of a pitiable object. So if you talk about any disability NGOs, if you go to the past, you'll find every NGO, rather than rights, is somehow grown on the concept of charity. Even now in the Western countries, if you go, you'll find huge charities. Oh, that's a pitiable character. Even now in Bhubaneswar, you go to the two schools, BBC school for the deaf or BB school for the blind, right here in the center of Bhubaneswar, next to Ram Mandir. Every Diwali, every birthday, their birthdays, you'll find people there with load of sweets, blankets, oranges, distributing it to the pitiable children. Until and unless this attitude changes, until and unless all of us start accepting persons with disabilities as equal partners, this planet cannot survive. Now this planet is experiencing one of its most challenging phase. It is about to disintegrate on its own because of the rising strifes, because of the hundreds of barriers we have created. Sociologists now in universities like Harvard, they have come up with the thought, with the idea that it is the inequity which we are creating at the level of childhood, the pinch of which the youth are getting, manifesting itself in criminality, manifesting itself in creating more inequities in the society. So small patchwork is not going to help, and we have to go down to the fundamentals. We have to reach our primary schools. We have to reach our mothers. We have to talk to them, the grandmothers, the mothers, the teachers and the schools. This is the place where change can come about. The third stereotype in which persons with disabilities exist is superhumans, the great heroes. Day in and day out, I always hear about this, Shruti, you have done a great thing, Shruti, you have done a wonderful thing, Shruti, you are doing great, and so many people come and give me awards. But the question is, why did Shruti do this? Shruti did this because of the humiliation, because of the challenges that came into Shruti's life. Shruti is not alone. Javed did it in Delhi. Anuradha did it in Delhi. Jayashree did it in Chennai. Dr. P.K. Malik did it in Kolkata. For all of us, there were choices in life. The choices in life were, should I take an easy life and live like that? Or should I take the challenge? For me, the opportunity came when I was working with as a volunteer in Disabled People's International, the big organization which brought about most of these changes across the world. And I had an opportunity to serve in the United Nations. I had another opportunity to serve as a permanent volunteer of DPI in Africa. But I chose to come back to my state and face the challenges, because after being a good student, after doing some great things, after qualifying for a service, one accident changed my entire world. 14th of April morning 1987, Shruti was this great achiever. 1987, 7:30 in the evening, Shruti was unwanted, Shruti was isolated, and Shruti was thrown away. She simply did not exist in either any human beings or any society's discourse. I thought of it this, through the difficult hours, through the days, through the months, through the years, what is it that is different now? How am I different? My thoughts are the same, so which means my brain is fine. My heart is the same. I can feel as I was feeling. What is the difference? The difference is a spinal cord injury which has broken my neck and paralyzed me from the neck. So what happens? Now all of you can sit on those chairs, but if you make me sit on those chairs, but these are small things. These things can be taken care of by aids, assistive devices, by providing some kind of a therapy. Unfortunately, at some point of the time, society thought, once you're physically challenged, you're gone for life. And that's, lot of it is because of the thinking that existed in our society. Now is a different time. I personally feel I am here today speaking to all of you for only two things. A wonderful family who never talked about disability. So when Pradeep Babu was talking, I could relate to him so much. When a person becomes disabled or has a child with disability, it is not one person suffering. It's a father, it's a mother, it's brother, sisters, spouses, everybody suffering. And all my life, what have I seen? If they are married, the husband is disabled, the wife devoutly stays with him. India or Western countries, now of course they are different, but I have seen, since 1996 I have been working in the international areas, wives do stay back. Come the disability of the wife, it takes only a few hours for the husband to leave her. So this is the kind of society in which we are living, which needs to change. How many times in my life I had to say, no, I am not mentally challenged. Mu pagalo nuhe. After my accident, I had to repeat this several times. I was a topper, a gold medalist, literary champion, Chancellor's Cup winner. But after my accident, when I go back to the university, same department, same professors, they nod their head. No, 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 Shruti cannot do a PhD, her fingers are bent. I go to so many private colleges to apply for a lecturership. I know all the people who are sitting there with me applying for that same lecturership. I know I'm the best of them all. But when the results comes out, one seat, I'm second. Two seats, I'm third. That's when I realized my wheelchair has become so huge. Its shadow is so strong that Shruti is dead, she is gone. And that's one point when I had decided to commit a suicide. But thanks to a wonderful family who was suffering with me, but at no point of time, they made me feel that I'm disabled. Every time I heard my father, he would always say, wake up, there is a lot to do, march ahead. You are my asset, you are my pride. You have to get back and do. And then slowly he started, when I started getting up, I started with tuitions. I started teaching children of class 6, class 7. Then he started telling me, I would tell him, I'm going on the road, I have gone to the cinema hall where people have asked me, tumhe kaun karchi hoti? I have gone to the hotels when people have asked me, what are you doing, Shruti? At that point of time, I had my younger sister, I remember in one such situation, I used to become sensitive, I used to cry. But my sister might be bold, she would stand in the cinema hall, in Kesari cinema, we had gone to watch Devdas. And somebody asked and she said, she is selected in the Olympics, we have come here for the practice. So humor and a strong family helped me. And couple of us decided, let us, if the world doesn't change, attitudes do not change, let us forget about other lucrative careers, let us focus on this, let us change, let us create a pathway. I won't get any facilities today, but 10 years down the lane, 12 years down the lane, the others who become disabled, they will find a path. There are wonderful, I am unable to actually tell you names. I know personally at least 70 to 100 persons with disability who in different corners of India are working day and night to create a wonderful society where people will write about disability. Filmmakers will make films on disability. When my colleague Malini Chip decided to write a novel, she wrote a book, My Little Finger. I remember when I called her, and she cannot speak. She's very severe cerebral palsy. She has to use a language synthesizer to speak. So when I called and said, Malini, congratulations. She said, don't congratulate me. I'm planning to leave India and go and live in London. But what happened? On exploring sexuality in persons with disability and how she explored her sexuality. And everybody was criticizing her. Everybody was raising a finger. Oh, Malini is such a girl. Oh, Malini did that. What do you expect a person with disability?